And now we are looking at the life of Solomon, the son of David. You're going to see a video in just a few minutes, not right now, but it's going to, the Bible project is going to show you the kings. And so we're going to watch that video this week, and then we're going to watch it again next week. They combine the two because originally they were combined as one collection of stories of the kings. But it really is, what you're going to do in 1 and 2 Kings is you're going to hit this apex of Israel's history in Solomon. And then Solomon is going to slide. And when he slides, the kingdoms come apart. And kings of the northern kingdom, kings of the southern kingdom, by and large, will be wicked people, unfit, totally antithetical to what God said in his word the king should look like, if he's going to be a king after his heart. So we're going to read 1 Kings 9, 1 to 9, kind of give you a flavor of this. If you would stand with me as we read this. This is in the aftermath, and if you know the storyline, in the aftermath of Solomon having built the temple for God. 1 Kings 9, 1 to 9. As soon as Solomon had finished building the house of the Lord and the king's house and all that Solomon desired to build, the Lord appeared to Solomon a second time as he had appeared to him at Gibeon. And the Lord said to him, I have heard your prayer and your plea, which you have made before me. I have consecrated this house that you have built by putting my name there forever. My eyes and my heart will be there for all time. As for you, if you will walk before me as David your father walked, with integrity of heart and uprightness, doing according to all that I have commanded you, keeping my statutes and my rules, then I will establish a royal throne over Israel forever, as I promised David your father, saying, you shall not lack a man on the throne of Israel. But if you turn aside from following me, you or your children, do not keep my commandments and my statutes that I have set before you, but go and serve other gods and worship them, then I will cut off Israel from the land that I have given them, and the house that I have consecrated for my name I will cast out of my sight, and Israel will become a proverb and a byword among all peoples, and this house will become a heap of ruins. Everyone passing by it will be astonished and will hiss. And they will say, why has the Lord done thus to this land and to this house? Then they will say, because they abandoned the Lord their God, who brought their fathers out of the land of Egypt, and laid hold on other gods and worshiped them and served them. Therefore the Lord has brought all this disaster on them. We've read together what? The inerrant, infallible, all-sufficient word of God. And the tragedy is that what God warned went unheeded, and what God said would happen happened in the life of one of the greatest men born of women in all time. Thank you. Be seated, if you would. We're going to show the Bible Project's video of the kings. Remember, he's going to deal with 1 and 2 Kings in one sitting, and so we'll come back and watch this again next week when we head into 2 Kings, Lord willing.
The books of 1 and 2 Kings, although they're two separate books in our Bibles, they were originally written as one book telling a unified story that continues on from the book of Samuel that came before it. So David has unified the tribes of Israel into a kingdom, and God promised that from his line would come a messianic king who would establish God's kingdom over the nations and fulfill the promises made to Abraham. So the book of Kings tells the story of the long line of kings that came after David, and none of them lived up to that promise. In fact, they run the nation of Israel right into the ground. The book is designed to have five main movements. The story begins and ends, focus on Jerusalem, first with Solomon's reign and the construction of the temple, and then in this last section, ending with Jerusalem's destruction and Israel's exile to Babylon. And the story leading up to this tragedy is what makes up the center three sections, which explain how Israel split into two rival kingdoms, how God tried to prevent the corruption of Israel by sending the prophets, and how exile became the unavoidable consequence of Israel's sin. The book opens with two chapters about the kingdom passing from the aging David to his son Solomon. And David's final words to Solomon, they're very similar to those of Moses and Joshua and Samuel to the people. It's a call to remain faithful to the commands of the covenant and to give allegiance to the God of Israel alone. But David's words ring somewhat hollow here, because David and Solomon then go on to conspire how they're going to consolidate this new kingdom through a whole series of political assassinations. It's not off to a great start. Solomon's brightest moment comes when he asks God for wisdom to lead Israel, and he even completes David's dream to make a temple for the God of Israel. Here the story actually stops and describes the design of this temple in detail, just like the tabernacle design in the Torah. There's all these gold and jewels and depictions of angels and fruit trees. It's all symbolism echoing back to the Garden of Eden. It's the place where heaven and earth meet, where God's presence dwells with his people. But no sooner does Solomon finish the temple that he makes some really horrible choices and the kingdom falls apart. He starts marrying the daughters of other kings, hundreds of them, for political alliances. And then he adopts their gods and introduces the worship of those gods into Israel. Solomon then accumulates huge amounts of wealth. He builds a huge army. He even institutes slave labor for all of his building projects. Now, if you go back to the Torah and look at God's guidelines for Israel's kings in Deuteronomy 17, Solomon is breaking every one. So by the time that he dies, Solomon resembles Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, more than he does his father David. The next section of the book opens with Solomon's son Rehoboam acting just like his father. It's a very sad story of greed and lust for power. He tries to increase taxes for slave labor. And under the leadership of Jeroboam, the northern tribes reject this, they rebel and secede, and form their own rival kingdom. And so now in the story, you have the southern kingdom, Judah, centered in Jerusalem with kings from the line of David, and now this new northern kingdom called Israel, whose capital will be Samaria eventually. Jeroboam also goes on to build two new temples to compete with Solomon's temple in the south. He puts a golden calf in each one to represent the God of Israel. The connection to Exodus 32 and the golden calf, it's all quite explicit. From this point on, the story goes back and forth from north to south, tracing the fate of both kingdoms. Each one had about 20 successive kings, and as the author introduces each king, he evaluates their reign by a few criteria. Did they worship the God of Israel alone, or did they promote the worship of other gods? Did they deal with idolatry among the people? And did they remain faithful to the covenant like David, or do they become corrupt and unjust? And according to these criteria, the author finds no good kings in northern Israel, 0 for 20. And then in southern Judah, only 8 out of 20 get a positive rating, which connects to another huge purpose in this book, and that's to introduce the role of the prophets, key figures in Israel's history. So in the Bible, prophets were not fortune tellers. Rather, they spoke on behalf of the God of Israel, and they played the role of covenant watchdogs, which means they called out idolatry and injustice among the kings and the people. They were constantly reminding Israel of their calling to be a light to the nations, that they should obey the commands of the Torah, and so the prophets challenged Israel to repent and follow their God. In these center sections for each king, God then raises up prophets to hold them accountable. And the most prominent prophets are the northern ones, Elijah and his disciple Elisha, right here in the center of the book. Elijah was a wild man of a prophet living out in the desert, and his arch nemesis was the northern king Ahab and his Canaanite wife Jezebel. Together, these two had instituted the worship of the Canaanite god Baal over Israel. And so in a famous story, Elijah challenged 450 prophets of Baal to a contest to see which god was real. So they both build altars and pray to their gods, but only the God of Israel answers with fire. After this, Ahab uses his royal power to murder an Israelite farmer and then steal his family's vineyard. And Elijah again confronts Ahab's injustice, and he announces the downfall of his house. Elijah eventually passes the mantle of his prophetic leadership to a young disciple named Elisha, who asks for 2 times the authority of Elijah. And what's fascinating here is how the author, he's recounted 7 miraculous feats for Elijah, and then he offers stories of 14 acts of power from Elijah. Both prophets were clearly remarkable men, and they played the same role, confronting Israel's kings for idolatry and injustice. And ultimately, they were unsuccessful in turning Israel back from apostasy. In the next section, the northern kingdom is rocked by a bloody revolution started by a king named Jehu, who destroys Ahab's family. And although Jehu was at first commissioned by God, his violence just gets out of control, and it creates the spiral of political assassinations and rebellions from which Israel never recovered. Coup follows coup after Jehu, and each king follows other gods, allows horrible injustice. It all leads up to 2 Kings chapter 17. The big bad empire of Assyria swoops down and takes out the northern kingdom altogether. And the capital city of Samaria, it's conquered, and the Israelites are exiled and scattered throughout the ancient world. Now, chapter 17 is key. The author stops the story and offers this prophetic reflection on what's just happened. He blames the downfall of the northern kingdom on the idolatry and covenant unfaithfulness of Israel and its kings. And so, God has allowed them to face the consequences of their decision. The final movement of the book tells the story of the lone southern kingdom. And here we meet some very heroic kings, like Hezekiah, who trusts God when the armies of Assyria come knocking on Jerusalem's door. Or Josiah, who discovers this lost scroll of the Torah in the temple. So he starts reading it. He's convicted and he institutes religious reforms to remove idolatry and Canaanite influences from the land. But Judah is just too far gone. The king, right in between these two, Manasseh, he's the worst by far. So he not only introduces the worship of idol statues into the Jerusalem temple, he also institutes child sacrifice. And so God sends prophets to say, the time is up. Israel has reached the point of no return. The final chapters tell the story of the Babylonian Empire coming to invade Jerusalem, destroy the temple, and carry the people and the royal line of David off into exile. And so the story ends leaving us wondering, is God done with Israel? Is he done with the line of David? Well, the final paragraph zooms about 40 years forward into the exile, and it tells a very odd story. It's about Jehoiakim, a descendant from David, who would have been king if he was back in Jerusalem. And the king of Babylon releases him from prison and invites him to eat at the royal table for the rest of his life, and the book ends. So it's not much, but it's a story that gives a glimmer of hope that God has not abandoned the line of David. So the question now is, how is God going to fulfill his promises to Abraham, to David? How is he going to bless the nations and bring the messianic kingdom? And to answer those questions, you have to read on into the wisdom and the prophetic books. But for now, that's the book of Kings.
Okay, and you can see he went all the way through 2 Kings. We're not going to do that tonight. We'll put it all together next week, Lord willing. So, 1 Kings. Now, the first half of it is the life, introduced to the life of Solomon. Under his leadership, Israel really ascends to her greatest days, her greatest size and glory through his accomplishments. He builds this incredible temple in Jerusalem. He garners worldwide fame and respect. But Solomon's zeal for God diminishes in his later years. These wives that he took on were really, they're called suzerainty treaties. The thinking behind this was, if I marry your daughter, then I take away any reason you might have to attack me. We have family. You have family here. And so he does this, 900 wives, and was very, very foolish in that. A lot of strife and jealousy, as you can imagine. And his heart, because they're pagan women, they're not Jewesses that would worship the one true God, they pull his heart away from the worship of God, and they diminish it and dilute it. In the temple of God. And so we have, one writer said this, I thought this was interesting. The king with the divided heart leaves behind a divided kingdom for the next century. And the book of 1 Kings traces the twin histories of two sets of kings and two nations filled with disobedient people, both of them, who are growing indifferent to God's prophets and his laws. So that's sort of an introduction to 1 Kings. If you look at the survey of it, we'll do it a little differently here. When you survey 1 Kings, and we're going to show you a graphic of this in a minute. As I said, the first half of it is about Solomon's life. And probably more than any man before him or since, He knew how to amass and creatively use wealth. With the exception of Jesus Christ, Solomon is regarded as the wisest man in human history. But in spite of all that, he takes his eyes off the Lord. And so you have in the first section of the book this united kingdom under Solomon's capable leadership, 1 through 11, and the divided kingdom in 12 to 22. The united kingdom really highlights Solomon's wisdom. For example, his half-brother Adonijah attempts to take the throne as David's death is nearing, and Nathan the prophet alerts David, who quickly directs the coronation of Solomon as a co-regent with him until he dies. When David dies, Solomon still has to consolidate his power and deal with those who oppose his rule. And this is what the video was talking about, where David and Solomon plot the demise of those who will be his enemies. And you notice Adonijah was one of them. But it's only when this is done, when he has checked, neutralized his enemies, that the kingdom can be established under the hand or under the rule of Solomon. From a theocratic perspective, Solomon's greatest achievement is the building of the temple. The ark is placed in this remarkable building, and it, all of its trappings, all of its accoutrements, when you go in, you have a sense of the glory of God abiding there, as God promised Solomon in chapter 9. There's a great prayer of dedication. Let's look at that. I don't have it up on the screen, but let's look at that real quickly. It's really one of the more powerful prayers in all of Scripture. And it's over in 1 Kings 8, verses 22 and following. It'll take a little bit to read, but this is well worth listening. Then Solomon stood before the altar of the Lord in the presence of all the assembly of Israel and spread out his hands toward heaven and said, O Lord, God of Israel, there's no God like you in heaven above or on earth beneath, keeping covenant and showing steadfast love to your servants who walk before you with all their heart. You've kept with your servant David, my father, what you declared to him. You spoke with your mouth and with your hand have fulfilled it this day. Now therefore, O Lord, God of Israel, keep for your servant David, my father, what you have promised him, saying, you shall not lack a man to sit before me on the throne of Israel, if only your sons pay close attention to their way, to walk before me as you have walked before me. Now therefore, O God of Israel, let your word be confirmed, which you have spoken to your servant David, my father. But will God indeed dwell on the earth? Behold, heaven and the highest heaven cannot contain you. How much less this house that I have built. Yet have regard to the prayer of your servant and to his plea, O Lord my God, listening to the cry and to the prayer that your servant prays before you this day, that your eyes may be open night and day toward this house, the place of which you have said, my name shall be there, that you may listen to the prayer that your servant offers toward this place, and listen to the plea of your servant and of your people Israel, when they pray toward this place, and listen in heaven, your dwelling place, when you hear, forgive. If a man sins against his neighbor and is made to take an oath and comes and swears his oath before your altar in this house, then hear in heaven and act and judge your servants, condemning the guilty by bringing his conduct on his own head, vindicating the righteous by rewarding him according to his righteousness. When your people Israel are defeated before the enemy because they have sinned against you, and if they turn again to you and acknowledge your name and pray and plead with you, in this house, then hear in heaven and forgive the sin of your people Israel and bring them again to the land that you gave to their fathers. When heaven is shut up and there is no rain because they have sinned against you, if they pray toward this place and acknowledge your name and turn from their sin, when you afflict them, then hear in heaven and forgive the sin of your servants, your people Israel, when you teach them the good way in which they should walk and grant rain upon your land, which you've given to your people as an inheritance. If there's a famine in the land, if there's pestilence or blight or mildew or locust or caterpillar, if their enemy besieges them in the land at their gates, whatever plague, whatever sickness there is, whatever prayer whatever plea is made by any man or by all your people Israel, each knowing the affliction of his own heart and stretching out his hands toward this house, then hear in heaven your dwelling place and forgive and act and render to each whose heart you know according to all his ways. For you only know the hearts of all the children of mankind, that they may fear you all the days that they live in the land that you gave to our fathers. Likewise, when a foreigner who is not of your people Israel comes from a far country for your name's sake, for they shall hear of your great name and your mighty hand and of your outstretched arm, when he comes and prays toward this house, hear in heaven your dwelling place and do according to all for which the foreigner calls to you, in order that all the peoples of the earth may know your name and fear you, as do your people Israel, and that they may know that this house that I have built is called by your name. If your people go out to battle against their enemy, by whatever way you shall send them, and they pray to the Lord toward the city that you have chosen and the house that I have built for your name, then hear in heaven their prayer and their plea and maintain their cause. If they sin against you, for there is no one who does not sin, and you are angry with them and give them to an enemy so that they are carried away captive to the land of the enemy, far off or near, yet if they turn their heart in the land to which they have been carried captive and repent and plead with you in the land of their captors, saying, we have sinned and have acted perversely and wickedly, if they repent with all their mind and with all their heart in the land of their enemies who carried them captive and pray to you toward their land, which you gave to their fathers, the city that you have chosen and the house that I built for your name, then hear in heaven your dwelling place, their prayer and their plea, and maintain their cause. And forgive your people who have sinned against you and all their transgressions that they have committed against you, and grant them compassion in the sight of those who carried them captive, that they may have compassion on them. For they are your people and your heritage, which you brought out of Egypt from the midst of the iron furnace. Let your eyes be open to the plea of your servant and to the plea of your people Israel, giving ear to them whenever they call to you. For you separated them from among all the peoples of the earth to be your heritage, as you declared through Moses your servant, when you brought our fathers out of Egypt, O Lord God. That's an incredible prayer. And you notice what's woven through it is he appeals to God's name upon the land that he gave them, God's name upon the house that he built for God, God's name upon his people. He's appealing to the glory of God all throughout it. And he sets up these scenarios, and it's fascinating to me that he even prays anticipating the possibility of being carried off in captivity before the Lord instructs him in the next chapter. Then we have the benediction. I just want to read this briefly. Now, as Solomon finished offering all this prayer and plea to the Lord, he arose from before the altar of the Lord, where he had knelt with hands outstretched toward heaven. And he stood and blessed all the assembly of Israel with a loud voice, saying, blessed be the Lord who has given rest to his people Israel, according to all that he promised. Not one word has failed of all his good promise, which he spoke by Moses his servant. The Lord our God be with us, as he was with our fathers. May he not leave us or forsake us, that he may incline our hearts to him, to walk in all his ways, and to keep his commandments, his statutes, his rules, which he commanded our fathers. Let these words of mine with which I have pleaded before the Lord be near to the Lord our God day and night. And may he maintain the cause of his servant and the cause of his people Israel, as each day requires, that all the peoples of the earth may know that the Lord is God, that there is no other. Let your heart, therefore, be wholly true to the Lord our God, walking in his statutes and keeping his commandments as at this day. It's one of the fascinating refrains as well, and it comes up in the benediction, is that all the peoples of the earth. Now, it's fascinating to me that, and this theme comes through in the prophets as well, that the Pharisees of Jesus' day really did not see that. They were thinking in terms of all the peoples of the earth need to come and become Jews. Anyone who becomes Jews from wherever they are on the earth, then they can be the favored people of God. You pick up some flavor of this in Solomon's prayer, but there's a really evangelical attitude toward the stranger, as he calls him earlier on in his prayer. It's a theme that you're going to see resounded. We picked it up in Moses. We're picking it up again under the kingly line. We pick it up in the prophets. And yet the Pharisees read it and essentially missed it, the notion that when Jesus would offend them, he would be teaching about how a Samaritan would be more merciful than Jews. And they just were highly offended by that. So we'll see that developing later on. After this season and Solomon, the crescendo ends, the very things that God has blessed him with. And there's a warning in the scripture that you need to be careful. If you forget God in the midst of blessing, then your blessings, though they came from God, will become a curse to you, because you will lose the sense of being thankful for the blessings and giving glory to God, and you will turn suddenly to being thankful for the blessings and forget where they came from and why they were given. And this is, Solomon's a prime example of this. All the wealth, all the power, all the prestige, and the very thing he prays that would not happen, happens to him. Another lesson in that. As we pray, we need to rise from prayer to say, now God, help me to walk in the way that I have prayed. And then remind ourselves that communing with God is more than a formal prayer of dedication. It's a day-by-day walk with him. These foreign wives, as I said, leading to idolatry. And here's one writer said this, the irony of history is that the wisest of men acts as a fool in his old age. God pronounces judgment and predicts that Solomon's son will rule only a fraction of the kingdom, that is Judah. Then you have the divided kingdom that follows. This king with a divided heart lets his people down, turns his back on God, and the result is not good. When Solomon dies, the warning of God comes to pass. And by the way, Father, we've seen this now over and over. If you obey, blessing. If you disobey, judgment. And that's the cycle that you can trace Israel all the way through that. We come into the new covenant, of course, and we understand that it's trust and obey, not raw obedience, not obedience in order to, but in the new covenant, obedience as evidence of trust and faith. So the kingdom is divided. Solomon's son Rehoboam chooses the foolish course of promising more severe taxation. It's ironic to me that Solomon, who would lead a people that God had led out of Egyptian slavery, that Solomon would resort to slavery himself. Well, another one of the great ironies. So Rehoboam imposes severe taxation. Jeroboam, who's an officer in Solomon's army, leads the 10 northern tribes to revolt, and they make him their king. And so it leaves Judah and Benjamin, those tribes, in the southern kingdom under Rehoboam. And then ensues a very chaotic period. Two nations, two sets of kings. Continual enmity and strife exists between the northern and the southern kingdoms. And the north is plagued by apostasy. You saw where Jeroboam sets up a false system of worship. They embrace the false gods and then bring them into temple worship. It's astounding. And the south is plagued by idolatry. When you look at all the kings listed, northern and southern, only Asa and Jehoshaphat, only them is it said of them that they did what was right in the eyes of the Lord. Out of all the kings, 20 in the north, 20 in the south. And so this is a very dark day. It's really, you call it Israel's dark ages, as they plummet to a people who are almost unrecognizable as a people set apart by God. Ahab brings a measure of cooperation between the northern and southern kingdom, but his kingship reaches new depths of wickedness. He's the man who introduces Jezebel's Baal worship to Israel. And the prophet Elijah, of course, steps in that great scene on Mount Carmel where he challenges the prophets of Baal, 450 of them. And if you haven't read it in a while, I'd encourage you to go back and read it. He gets to a point, he seizes upon their frenetic mentality and taunts them as they cry out to Baal. And he says, well, perhaps he's sleeping. Maybe you should cry louder. He just can't hear you. And he taunts them that way. And they begin to do the strange things. They cut themselves. They go through all sorts of self-flagellation and mutilation in order to appeal to this bloodthirsty false god of theirs. And of course, you know that miraculously God comes and consumes the altar. And then the prophets of Baal are put to death. Of course, then Jezebel gets her sights set on Elijah, and you know the story that goes on there. They have treachery concerning Naboth's vineyard, causes Elijah to rebuke him. Ahab repents, but he later dies in battle because of his refusal to heed the words of Micaiah, another prophet on the scene. Now let's look at this just real quickly you're following it along to see how it sketches out. Go back, if you will, Michelle, to the United Kingdom, and let's look at this just real quickly. Been called a kingdom in tranquility. Jerusalem is the capital. Solomon reigns 40 years, and that's as we said, the first half of the book. Now go to the divided kingdom slide. It's in turmoil. Two kingdoms now, north and south, for 90 years. Samaria is the capital of Israel in the northern kingdom. Jerusalem, the capital of Judah in the southern kingdom. And you see what happens. Kingdoms divided. Various kings reign. Ahab reigns, and the encounters that he and Elijah have with one another, the reign of Jehoshaphat in Judah, and then the reign of Ahaziah in Israel. And so that's going to bring to an end the book of 1 Kings. The title itself, some interesting things about how we get this title. It's In the Hebrew Bible, the original title was Melakim, which is simply the word kings, plural. And it's from the first word in chapter 1, verse 1 of what we call 1 Kings. Now the king. The Septuagint, the Greek translation of the Old Testament, artificially divided the book of Kings in the middle of the story of Ahaziah into two books, what we call 1 and 2 Kings. So in the Septuagint, it gave titles to the books of Samuel and the books of Kings, and it called the books of Samuel 1 and 2 Kingdoms, and the books of Kings 3 and 4 Kingdoms. That's how the Septuagint divided it. And the reason for that that's been given in some of the studies I did was because the Greek text required a greater amount of scroll space than did the Hebrew. Then, of course, the Latin term for it is Liber Regum Tertius et Quartus, and that's simply third and fourth book of Kings. The author is, again, we wonder about that. The author probably was Jeremiah, it seems, and then some of the students of Jeremiah would have completed the writing after the death of Jeremiah. He was a historian. Both 1 and 2 Kings emphasize God's righteous judgment on idolatry and immorality. So the focal point when this is written is the spiritual condition. Yes, it is historical narrative, but it's historical narrative told from a spiritual or theological perspective of the demise of the people of God. And there's a phrase, I'll just show it to you in a couple of places, it's similar to what you're going to find in Jeremiah, this phrase, to this day. And that's very much the style of Jeremiah. Look at 1 Kings 8:8 and 1 Kings 12:19. 1 Kings 8:8, and the poles were so long that the ends of the poles were seen from the holy place before the inner sanctuary, but they could not be seen from outside, and they are there to this day. Talking about when this was written, to this day. 1 Kings 12:19. So Israel has been in rebellion against the house of David to this day. So it's a stylistic thing that you'll find in Jeremiah's writings. The last two chapters of 2 Kings were written after the Babylonian captivity, probably by one of the Jewish captives in Babylon. The majority, it seems, of 1 and 2 Kings was written before 586 BC by a compiler who had access to the historical documents. Here's some historical documents that are mentioned. We saw this in the Samuel material. Look at 1 Kings 11:41. where it references this book of the Acts of Solomon. We told you that the kings, either themselves or some of their what's called amanuenses, would chronicle their acts. And so there's this reference point. Another one is in 1 Kings 11:41. Now the rest of the Acts of Solomon and all that he did and his wisdom, are they not written in the book of the Acts of Solomon? Then there's this book called the Book of the Chronicles of the Kings of Israel. 1 Kings 14:19 shows that. Now the rest of the acts of Jeroboam, how he warred and how he reigned, behold, they are written in the book of the Chronicles of the Kings of Israel. And then we have this book called the Book of the Chronicles of the Kings of Judah. Look at, there's two passages, 1 Kings 14:29, 1 Kings 15:7. First of all, now the rest of the acts of Rehoboam and all that he did, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of the Kings of Judah? And then again, 15:7. The rest of the acts of Abijam and all that he did, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of the Kings of Judah? And there was war between Abijam and Jeroboam. So probably these books that are referenced are part of an official court record. Notice 2 Kings 18:18. When they called for the king, there came out to them Eliakim, the son of Hilkiah, who was over the household, and Shebna, the secretary, and Joah, the son of Asaph, the recorder. So there's this, you get this sense here that when they came with this collection of people who would be there to write down the necessary retelling of what the king was doing. As far as the date and setting of the book, it's written to the remaining kingdom of Judah before and after its Babylonian exile. The majority of it was compiled by some contemporary of Jeremiah, if not by Jeremiah himself, between 646 and 570 BC. It is a record of disobedience, idolatry, ungodliness, and it explains why these two captivities take place, the Assyrian captivity with the northern kingdom in 722 BC and the Babylonian captivity of Judah, the southern kingdom, in 586 BC. 1 Kings covers 120 years from the beginning of Solomon's reign in 971 BC through Ahaziah's reign ending in 851 BC. The key date is 931 BC. It's the year the kingdom was divided into the northern nation of Israel and the southern nation of Judah. And I have a graphic I want to show you now, if you can see that. It kind of gives you a timeline. You have 1043, which was shows the mark the beginning of the reign of Saul, until 1011. David takes over until 971, then Solomon until 931. And then you begin to see the split into the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom and the kings that rule. And we'll show you more of that next week and begin to tie some of where the prophets fit in to this as well. The theme and purpose of 1 Kings is that the welfare of Israel and Judah, and we've seen this before now, depended upon the covenant faithfulness of the people and their king. It's a historical account of the reigns of the kings from Solomon to Jehoshaphat in Judah and Solomon to Ahaziah in Israel. But the two books of Kings as a whole trace the monarchy from the point of its greatest prosperity under Solomon to its demise and destruction in the two captivities. It's this recurring theme that the welfare of the nations depended upon the covenant faithfulness of the people and their king. And in this case, the king turns away, then the kings turn away and the people turn away as well. As far as the theological significance of it, I've got some, it's a prophetically oriented evaluation of the spiritual and moral causes that led to the destruction of the two kingdoms. Just want to give you some principles here that I came across. One, a man cannot properly rule himself without conscious dependence upon the help of God. We've seen this, again, it's a recurring theme. And the reason we point this out is you need that the Bible, there's a wovenness in the fabric of the story of the Bible that really doesn't change much. You heard God warn Solomon in the ninth chapter that we read. I'm going to bless you. I'm going to prosper you. My name will be upon this house and to your sons. unless. And then the warning, if you turn away, sons turn away, then I will turn away. And the consequences of God turning away are that the very things that look so wonderful now will just come crashing down. Second thing is that the kings had great responsibility as God's administrators because the circumstances of the nation depended in large part upon their faithfulness to Yahweh. Go back to Joshua. When Moses is stepping aside and Joshua steps up to lead, though he is not officially a king, the principles there are the same, that this word shall not depart from you. You shall meditate upon it day and night. The idea was God's leader would saturate himself in the word so that he would not forget God's promises and God's commandments. And clearly, you cannot even imagine that Solomon, though he may have early on in his reign, he did not keep up his devotion to God. And there's a principle there for all of us, folks. If we are not consistently devoted to God in terms of prayer and feeding upon his word, our hearts will turn cold. And we can be deceived. We can be misled, just as the wisest man who ever lived was. Third, the kings were illustrations of the people as a whole. Just as they disregarded God's prophets, so did the people. And there's really a tension throughout the reign of these kings where they very seldom heed the admonition, exhortations, and instructions that God has given to his prophets to give to the kings. And then observance of God's law produces blessing, but apostasy is rewarded by judgment. Again, we in the New Covenant era see that that's the flowing out of trust, of faith in Christ. But faith, we sing that hymn, trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. That's a very evangelical, biblical principle. It does not say obey and trust. That would have the order out of whack. But trust and obey. But the principle is still the same. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever person sows, that shall he also reap. So you learn this. What about the keys to it? Well, if you're looking for a key term or key word, the division of the kingdom, what I entitled this study tonight. The key verses, we read a couple of them earlier, but I want to cite chapter 9, verses 4 and 5, and then chapter 11, verse 11. Look at 9, 4 and 5. And as for you, if you will walk before me as David your father walked with integrity of heart and uprightness. We'll stop a minute. Notice how merciful God is. Too often, if I say David, what's the first thing that comes to your mind? Adultery and murder. That great fall of his. Notice how full of mercy God is. He is looking at the tenor of David's life. And so he cites him as a man who, with integrity of heart and uprightness, doing according to all that I have commanded you and keeping my statutes and my rules, then I will establish your royal throne over Israel forever, as I promised David your father, saying, you shall not lack a man on the throne of Israel. Now, of course, we know that things went haywire. Captivity took place. But we also know that in the context that was given, it was a strong messianic prophecy. And when Jesus comes, he comes to ascend to the throne of his father, David. Then 1 Kings 11:11, therefore the Lord said to Solomon, since this has been your practice, and you have not kept my covenant and my statutes that I have commanded you, I will surely tear the kingdom from you and will give it to your servant. The key chapter is chapter 12, if you're looking for sort of a focal point. When the United Kingdom becomes a divided kingdom, Solomon dies, Rehoboam becomes king, and of course we told you from there on it's two kingdoms, two capitals, two kings simultaneously, and two religions, sadly. What about Jesus Christ? Where do we see Jesus in the book of 1 Kings? That's what this study is all about. Well, just as in the life of David, even though he had flaws, in the life of David we see much of a foreshadowing of the person of Jesus Christ. So much so he's called the Son of David. Just in that way we see in Solomon, the wisdom of Solomon, And you have in 1 Corinthians 1:30, Paul says, because of him you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. Jesus is called the wisdom of God. When you go to the book of Proverbs and you read through it, and wisdom speaks, wisdom is a personification of the coming Messiah of God. And so Solomon the wise, as we would call him, wise for a season, Solomon the wise becomes for us a type of Jesus Christ. Also, Solomon's his fame and his glory and his wealth and his honor foreshadow Christ and his kingdom, who will be over all, in all, rule and overrule, subdue all other kingdoms under him. And so Matthew 12:42, listen to this. The queen of the south will rise up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it, for she came from the ends of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon, and behold, something greater than Solomon is here. Jesus likens the queen of Sheba, who comes to show obeisance to Solomon, and says, she will rise up and condemn you, this generation, because one wiser than Solomon is in your midst, and you're rejecting him, you despise him, you disregard him. The prophet Elijah, as he pops up, is more typical of John the Baptist than of Christ. He's the forerunner who is preparing the way. And so pivotal is he that, remember, on the Mount of Transfiguration, when Jesus goes and takes Peter, James, and John with him, that he communes with Moses, who typifies the law, and Elijah, who typifies the prophets. And so he is the typical, ultimate typical prophet, foreshadowing John the Baptist, who would prepare the way for the Christ. Even though his prophetic ministry and miraculous works show us aspects of the life of Jesus. Well, what's the contribution to the Bible of 1 Kings? One writer said this. In 1 Samuel, the kingdom was established. In 2 Samuel, it was consolidated. 1 Kings brings the kingdom from the height of its glory to a sudden abyss of division and decline. And it begins a set pattern in its portrayal of each king that is carried on in 2 Kings. We're going to see that next week. The account shifts between the kings of Israel and the kings of Judah in a way that synchronizes the two monarchies. The introductory and concluding formulas are used, and a theological verdict on the reign of each king is passed. The life and reign of David is the standard by which the kings of Judah are judged, and none of them rise to meet it. Also, 1 Kings introduces to us really the beginning of the flourishing of the prophetic ministry and how it came into maturity at the end of the United Kingdom and throughout the days of the divided kingdom. And several of God's prophets are described, and we'll be, as I said, we're going to be tying those together in a timeline for you next week. That is a summary of the book of 1 Kings. So we're heading with Israel now into a very dark era, and it will be the thundering of the prophets and how the people respond to that will chart their course. So much so, that when we've come through Malachi, the gap between Malachi and the New Testament period is a 400-year period of silence where God has no prophetic voice for his people. And so it kind of shows you the downgrade.